Okay, welcome back to our Breslov seminar on lesson 35 of the Bridge Likutei Moran. Hope everyone is okay. Bezat Hashem, we're going to continue with where we left off last week on this amazing lesson, Rebbe Nachman's teaching on connecting to the mind, connecting to the chokhmah, connecting to knowledge as the means to cleansing and purifying the mind. And part of this is also the idea of sleep, proper sleep, holiness, sleeping properly, and getting everything in proper perspective in life, and also renewing the mind, getting rid of extraneous thoughts, and through all of this, to be being able to deal wisely, if you want to say, with wisdom, in getting rid of all the bad habits, on the unnecessary lusts and desires and bad habits and bad midot, bad attributes, getting rid of everything through the wisdom, through chokhmah, through having the brain in its proper place, having the mind in its proper place. It's an amazing lesson, because here you see how Rabbi Nachman's advice is to dealing with problems at their source. You can have a child at school who the teachers are complaining, they're not listening, and the child is overweight, and they have acne, you know, on their face, and all types of things, and they're trying to help the child. Maybe she needs to do this type of a test and that, the type of a test. Really, what's missing in anyone's life is to go to the source. The source is to get the chokhmah. In other words, so there's something in the person's head which is wrong. That means there's something stuck there that shouldn't be there, a misconception, a misunderstanding. When that is taken out, then the mind can flourish. The mind can spread. The knowledge can spread throughout the brain, and self-healing can take place. So long as there's something stuck in the person's head, the body cannot self-heal. I think we mentioned it last week, what the Gemara says, that the soul is what sustains and nourishes the entire body. Just like Hashem sustains the world, the Gemara says this, just like Hashem sustains the world, so too the soul sustains the body. But what's needed is to connect the soul to the body. And we said, if you remember last week, the place of the soul, where the neshama, the upper soul, resides, is in the head. And because of that, so the soul is connected to chokhmah, to getting chokhmah into it. When the soul is present and spreading and healthy, when a person has, if you want to call it, a healthy soul, then the soul can take care of the body. But when the soul is not healthy, so this leads to all types of derivatives, byproducts, things happening, right? Results of things that are not functioning properly in the body, all types of physical ailments and sicknesses, etc. Mental illnesses also. What's needed is to get the neshama functioning properly. And Rabbi Nachman teaches in this lesson, the neshama is dependent mainly on receiving proper chokhmah, proper knowledge within it. And that, we said, requires that a person is very, very careful in what they allow into their head, making sure that what comes in, the information coming into my head, is only pure and will only benefit and allow the presence of true chokhmah into the brain. And also, we said the second thing is that when the person's brain is overworked, meaning that the neshama needs a recharge to its source, which we said is called the ora panim, the light of the countenance. I think we'll go into these topics more as we develop the lesson. That, for that, sleep is needed. Sleep, when it's done properly, this recharges the neshama to reconnect to the source of wisdom. And by doing so, a person can face another day of challenges and overcome them through the neshama, simply through the force of the neshama, of the upper soul. And because of that, Rav Nosson writes a lot, both in his prayer on this lesson 35, and also an amazing, beautiful discourse he has based on this lesson 35 in his book called Likutei Halachot, which as yet is not yet available in English. God willing, we hope it will be very soon. He has an amazing lesson explaining, like I said, also in his prayer, the importance of saying the Shema, Kriyat Shema, before going to sleep. It is of paramount importance. This is the main key which determines the quality of your sleep, and that when you wake up, you really wake up. Because you have people who wake up and they're still exhausted, they're still drained. Like the expression goes, they wake up on the wrong side of the bed. What determines that your sleep is really a beneficial, healthy sleep for the neshama is a lot is dependent on saying the Kriyat Shema prayer before. And he says, Rav Nosim, to the extent of saying the Kriyat Shema with what is called in Hebrew, Mesirat Nefesh. In other words, putting your soul in your hands by saying this prayer with a lot of energy, even though for most people it's very hard, because by the time they want to go to sleep, people are exhausted, they're drained, they're tired. Because of that, a person has to find many types of tactics how to go to sleep with energy. The sleeping will take place when I sleep, but before sleeping, until the point they go to sleep, to be energized, so I can say the Kriyat Shema prayer properly. One of the big advices is to be careful not to eat so much before going to sleep, because eating makes a person very heavy and groggy. So when a person eats at night, it just assists him to go to sleep better. But he loses, because of that, the ability to say Kriyat Shema properly before going to sleep. It is of paramount importance, the Kriyat Shema. It's a halacha, by the way. It's an obligation. It's part of the code of Jewish law that a Jew before going to sleep has to say Kriyat Shema. Many people mislook it, overlook it. They don't take it seriously. They fall asleep while saying it. It's something which will a lot determine the quality of a person's sleep. It's said about one of the Breslovers of the previous generation, Rav Shmuel Shapira of blessed memory, that there was a time in his life when it took him 2 hours. Do you hear this? 2 hours to recite the bedtime Shema. 2 hours. He said it word for word, pouring out his heart, pouring out his insides in the words with such Mesirat Nefesh. Because a lot is dependent on how you go to sleep, and that's dependent on the Kriyat Shema. There was a Breslover of the previous generations in Uman. His name was Rav Mendel Litvak, of blessed memory. And this person was very careful not to eat before going to sleep. And in the Ukraine, like most northern countries, there's a big gap between the latest time for Mincha and the earliest time for davening the evening prayer, Arvit. Some places it's a 40-minute gap. Some places it'd be up to an hour. In Israel, for example, in Yerushalayim, there's 20 minutes between Mincha and Arvit. But other places have even up to an hour, hour and a half. So many people take that opportunity to learn between Mincha and Arvit. And some people also eat at that time, so they don't have to eat afterwards. So the Rav Mendel Litvak, once he was visiting the city of Uman, and the Breslovers offered him, you know, would you like some soup? So he said a joke, which in Yiddish it rhymes, but in English it's like this. If this stomach eats the soup, in Yiddish the word for soup is yoich, and the word for stomach is boich, so it rhymes. He says, in the boich is geven yoich. If now I put the soup in this stomach won't wake up for midnight, for the midnight lamentation. In other words, I'll have great difficulty in getting up. And just another story that's coming to my head, a bit funny, about how a person really has to do things in order to be able to get up. I know we're going off a little, but waking up also is very important. It's one thing to sleep, but it's another thing not to oversleep, because the time you lose in your life from sleep, you'll never get it back. The zman, the time that's lost, there's no greater loss in life than the loss of time. Every person who does tshuva later on, they're always complaining, oh, I lost all those years from not learning Torah, not davening, not knowing about religion, about Hashem, right? So people complain that if only I would have known, I would have used my time wisely, etc. So time is a very big, very important thing. It's important to sleep. Like Rebbe Nachman said, eat and sleep, and sleep, just watch your time. Eat and drink, just make sure you watch your time, not to oversleep. To be awake when you have to be awake, and to be asleep when you're really asleep. So there was a Breslover, Rabbi Leo Chaim Rosen, him and his wife, they moved here to Israel from Russia in 1936. And for many years, for maybe 40 years, he slept on, and his wife also, they slept on a bed made of straw, kash, straw beds. It's something you hear from like the farmers of 100 years ago, 200 years ago, had a bed of straw. So one of his disciples, Rabbi Tzvi Aryeh Rosenfeld, of blessed memory, one of the main leading Breslovers in America, who brought the Breslov movement in America to the United States, North America, he saw the condition of Rabbi Elio Chaim Rosen's bed. So him and his disciples, they bought Rabbi Elio Chaim Rosen and his wife normal beds with springs, normal beds, cushiony beds. They brought him the gift. And Rabbi Rosenfeld went back to America, and he came back to visit like 6 months later, and he sees the new mattresses that they bought for Rabbi Elio Chaim Rosen and his wife. They're standing up, sitting, standing against the wall in the front balcony, the front porch. So Rav Rosenfeld asked Rav Elio Chaim Rosen, you know, how come you're not using the new mattresses that we bought you? So he said, it's too comfortable, I can't wake up. You made the beds too comfortable, I can't get up now. Me and my wife, we can't get up. How do you expect it to wake up in the middle of the night to do chatzot, to do the midnight prayer? The bed is so comfortable. You know, I'm losing out now. So he continued sleeping on the straw beds. The point is, sleep is very important, which is what we're going to see in this lesson. But also getting up. More important than the sleep is the waking up. Which is why, by the way, Rebbe Nachman wasn't so much supportive of the view, of the opinion of certain people. It's so important to be up at midnight. So instead of going to sleep and then trying to wake up in the middle of the night for midnight, let's stay awake at the whole beginning of the night until midnight. That way I'll be up for midnight. Rabbi Nachman said the main thing in getting up at midnight is going to sleep and breaking the sleep to wake up. It's true, it's very difficult, but the waking up part of the sleep is what adds the power and the benefit of the midnight prayer. In other words, the whole midnight prayer is based on breaking the sleep, which is the theme of this lesson. Hit'oruta shena. When you wake up from the sleep, what happens is that your neshama is recharged with this big level of wisdom, which is above wisdom. It's called Or HaPanim, the light of the countenance. And with that energy, you say the midnight prayer. Even though you might say it half awake, like a drunk person, extremely exhausted, but that benefit that the soul got of being asleep and then awakened is so important. That's why, again, it's a very big supported opinion by Rabbi Nachman to go to sleep early. Not to be so much a night person. For the majority of the people in the world, it's very, very difficult to go to sleep early, especially when almost every night there's another occasion. There's a wedding, there's a bar mitzvah, there's many things, there's giving classes, there's many, many excuses. Some people have to work even, right? So a person, the best they can do in the meantime is to pray to Hashem that they have an organized, good, consistent schedule at night, that they can go to sleep early and wake up to have that opportunity to wake up at midnight. If you can't do it, at least you can daven about it, at least to know its value, and not to say, this is not for me. Instead of saying it's not for me, to yearn for it, I want this, but right now I can't do it. So all I can do now is to daven and yearn to have an amazing schedule at night. Because again, waking up at midnight, tasting, serving Hashem, crying out to Hashem, hitbodedut, Torah study after midnight, anyone who's tasted it will tell you, will attest to you, it's a different world. It's a totally different world than learning Torah any other time of the day. The experience and connection to Hashem from midnight for the next 2 hours after that is so powerful. Anyone who's tasted it can see that nothing in the world compares to that experience. It's something very precious, and it's a shame the majority of the world has no clue, has no idea what this actually is. They've never tasted it. But someone who's tasted this experience of getting up at midnight and being involved in serving Hashem at that time will tell you clearly that nothing in the world can be compared to this. Even all the gold and money in the world cannot be exchanged for this amazing experience of being up at night alone with Hashem, opening up your heart, Torah study, prayer, saying the midnight lament, the tikkun chatzot, the dirges, which are recited at midnight. It is something so powerful, especially now the winter nights begin. Rav Pinchas of Koretz, he would call these nights the gildene nacht in Yiddish, the golden nights, because the nights are so long, you can accomplish so much at these nights. If it's within your ability to do so, it's worth investing in this. And if it's not, at least you have what to daven about, to reach a goal of being able to get up at midnight and to experience the unbelievable light of this experience. Okay, with all that said, we're now going to continue this amazing lesson that we started last week. We're using again the abridged Likutei Moran, lesson number 35, paragraph number 2. You can download the free PDF of this class, which was attached to all the notifications of this class. You have a free PDF download on this lesson, so you can follow with me in English or in Hebrew, as you wish. Paragraph number 2. Alken, going back to guarding the head, guarding the mind, the first part of this lesson, before we're getting into the sleep. Alken, therefore, Tzarich kol adam lishmor me'od et sichlo u'machashavto. Therefore, a person has to guard very much his intellect and his thoughts. Shelo yachnis b'machshavto shum machshava chitzona, not to allow to enter into his thoughts any foreign thought. V'shum chochma chitzona, and no foreign, unfamiliar, unacceptable knowledge. O machshava zara, or any like bad outside thought, right? Umikosheken hirurim ra'im, and all the more so like illicit immoral thoughts, which a person should avoid having their mind involved in such vulgar thoughts, which can only bring a person down. Because he explains now, kikol hapgamim, because all of a person's blemishes, and all of the person's sins, right, and iniquities, God forbid, that he's done, where do they come from? What led a person to sin? Kulam einam ba'im ki'im alide pigama machshava kana. They only come to a person through the blemish of his thoughts, God forbid, mentioned above. That what? She'enu nizhar leshomra karaui. That a person is not on guard, on check, checking that his mind is not allowing anything foreign to enter it, only things which are proper. Shelo tetze chutz migvula kedusha, that the mind should not drift away out of the boundaries of holiness. Because again, the thoughts you have in your head determine your actions, your activity, determines if you fall into bad deeds, into negative actions. First, you can have all types of, like we said, addictions and negative attitudes and characteristics. Check that person's head. See what this person is allowing into his head. If you have a person all day, on a simple level, look, you have a person all day watching Holocaust movies, Holocaust videos, so automatically the person will always be negative, because they are just allowing negativity into their head, negativity. So the person will have like a very down and negative attitude, because he's always seeing death and starvation and hunger. So how do you expect such a person to be positive and developing? He's allowing something negative into his head. There has to be a gvul, a border, a limit. There's time for everything. There's a time to, yes, maybe watch a Holocaust movie. But if now it's going to reach a level, a person is just so connected to it, and he reaches a negative attitude in general, so you have to always check what is a person letting into his head. An amazing story that just came across my head, I may have mentioned it before, is that there was a big rabbi in America from the Litvish world. His name was Rabbi Aharon Cutler. Rabbi Aharon Cutler was one of the founding rabbis of the famous Lakewood Yeshiva in New Jersey. And being a Litvish rabbi, in general, the Litvish way is not necessarily accepting the Hasidic attitude of a Rebbe and Hasidim, etc. It's different, because like Rebbe Nachman said, the Litvish people are more into the learning, and the Hasidim are more into the davening. And by the way, Rabbi Nachman said, I hold by both, to be a good davener and a good learner, to invest in both areas. So Rav Aaron Cutler in general wasn't so positive and didn't look so much on a good eye towards Hasidic Rebbes. He said, There's only one Rebbe I hold by, and I ask forgiveness. I forgot the name of the Rebbe, but there was a Rebbe living at that time in Brooklyn, in New York, and Rav Aaron Cutler said, I only hold by him, that this man really has divine spirit, Ruach HaKodesh. What was the story? The story was that back then, in the 1950s or 1960s, when Rabbi Aaron Cutler was the Rosh Yeshiva of his yeshiva in Lakewood, there was one of the top students in the yeshiva who began to have a problem, and he confided with Rabbi Cutler about his problem. He said, I'm really sorry about this happening. I don't know what's wrong with me, but I'm beginning to have a lot of thoughts of idolatry. When learning and when davening, I see in front of my eyes the cross, the Christian cross, and I can't get it out of my head, and I'm having tendencies towards Christianity. I don't know what's happening with me. And Rav Aaron Cutler was shocked. One of his top students having this happen to him, he didn't know what to do. He tried all types of things, maybe learn like this, maybe learn like that. Nothing was working. So in this time, there happened to be a wedding, and Rabbi Aaron Cutler was invited to this wedding. Here's the name of the Rebbe. Now remember, the name of the Rebbe was the Kapishnitzer Rebbe in New York, in Brooklyn. At this wedding, Rabbi Aaron Cutler was invited, and he saw the Kapishnitzer Rebbe also there. So someone and people close to Rabbi Aaron Cutler knew about the problem, and they suggested Rabbi Cutler, maybe bring it up to this Hasidic Rebbe. And he said, how could they help? What can you do? He said, give it a shot. So, you know, obviously such big, very special people are sitting together. They said at the wedding, Rav Aaron Cutler sat next to the Kapishnitzer Rebbe. And he told the Kapishnitzer Rebbe about the problem with one of his top students in the yeshiva. So the Kapishnitzer Rebbe told Rav Aaron Cutler, ask your student, how does he adjust his wristwatch? Ask him how he adjusts the watch. Rav Cutler couldn't believe what he heard. What does his watch have to do with his thoughts of idolatry? He said, he doesn't know what he's talking about. So the other people who were close to Rav Cutler, they asked, what did he say? And he said to check his watch. He said, give it a shot. So Rabbi Cutler, the next day, he sent for the disciple, the top student, and he asked him, can I ask you, please, this funny question? How do you adjust your watch, your wristwatch, when you need to adjust the time? So the student said, across the field from the dormitory of the yeshiva, there's a church, and the church has a very, very big clock on it, and the time is always right. So I adjust my wristwatch using the clock of the church. So Rav Cutler, quickly, in an instant, he said, that's it. That's it. You're getting benefit from the clock of the Avodah Zarah, this halacha. You're not allowed to gain any benefit from any trace of idolatry. Even a clock, even a clock on a church, which you might think, what does it have to do with the idol worship? Idol worship is idol worship, and the clock is as a clock. But because the clock is on the building of the idolatry, it is a problem gaining benefit, looking for the time, using the clock of the church clock. So he said to the student, that's it. Because now you're using the clock of the church to adjust your wristwatch, so this benefit stuck in your head. It's something foreign, and this is causing you to have these negative feelings of idolatry. He told him immediately, stop using that clock, and he stopped, and there was an immediate change noticeable. From that time on, by the way, Rav Cutler began to respect exceedingly the Kapishnitzer Rebbe. He would send people to him to get blessings and everything, because he recognized that this man was a real tzaddik who had divine inspiration. But going back to what we're saying in this lesson, is you gotta check the head. When there's a problem, when there's something wrong, when a person feels is trapped in his bad attitudes, bad traits, negative traits, desires, and lusts, check what's in the head. Go to the source. Go to the source of the person, see the head, fix the thoughts. That's what Rebbe Nachman is saying here. You got to put into check what you allow into your head. You can't just watch any movie you want. You can't just read any news article you want. You can't just read any book you want. You have to be careful. You can do as you wish. But if you really want to work on yourself, you have to put on a filter. You have to filter what you allow in. Ah, it's only a movie. Ah, it's only a football game. You don't know. I'm not saying anything that it's for sure this, for sure that. A person has to do a lot of davening, that Hashem opens their eyes to see what could be the source of my negative attitude and my negative situation, where I'm acting in a certain way which is not beneficial, that I have overeating problems, I have this type of problems, smoking addictions, alcohol, you know, depression, phobias, like crazy thoughts. Where is it coming from? What am I allowing into my head? That's what a person has to be very, very careful about. You have to filter what you're letting in, and then the result is you begin to see that you're more refined. And when you're more refined because of the head, like we said, the neshama can play a major part in controlling and healing and nourishing the body. And when there's proper nourishment in the body, there's no need for excesses, for negative tendencies, for addictions. There's no room for that. It's only, you know, some people, when they get stressed and in a stressful situation, then they overeat or they smoke a cigarette or they do something which they don't want to do, but they run to it because of the stress of the situation. So what's needed is to fix the head, that even in a stressful situation, I have mind over matter, I have control, so I won't fall in. That's what he's talking about here, Rebbe Nachman. A lot is dependent on what you let in. Let's continue. כל הפגמים בכל החטאים והבנות חס ושלום, כולם אינם באים כי אם על ידי פגם המחשבה כנר, שאינו נזהר לשומרה כראוי, שלא תצא חוץ מגבול הקדושה. All this we read already. וכשנזהר ושומר היטב המחשבה, and when a person is very careful and watches very much his thoughts, שיהיה חוכמה שבמוח, which is the knowledge in the brain, זהו עיקר תיקונו ותשובתו על ההבנות. This, he's saying, is the address. This is the proper rectification and repentance for sins. When a person wants to do tshuva, the first thing they have to cut off of is what they were letting into the head until now. If a person was just so connected to secular movies and stuff like that, and that's what was really in his head, which led him to act and behave and do things the way he did, so by now, solving the problem at its source, by putting in check very carefully what you allow into your head, this Rabbi Nachman is saying here is the main rectification of a person's sins. Can you believe that? His main tshuva, repentance, and rectification of the sins is in the area of the thought, of the mind. שמתגבר לגרש כל המחשבות החיצוניות מדעתו ושכלו. That the person is strengthening himself to kick out, to literally kick out all foreign thoughts from his mind and his intellect, his brain. Because like we said, the intellect is the corresponding limb of the person which corresponds to the soul. That's the brain, the mind. And when a person sanctifies his sechel by filtering what he lets into it, he's actually sanctifying the neshama, his soul. Ad yedei zeh magbia umeshiv hakol lesichlo, is able to elevate and return everything to his intellect. Vezeh ikar tshuva, and this is the essence of tshuva. What does that mean? To now elevate and return everything to his sechel. Because we said that the brain, the neshama, is what nourishes the body, so everything connected to the body is rooted in the neshama. Now, since the neshama corresponds to the mind, the knowledge, when the knowledge is in check, meaning the neshama has now a major presence in the person's mind, so now all of a person's activity and actions and what he goes through in his day have an elevation. You are now returning. That means even negative, bad activity that I may have done in the past, I can now rectify it, because now that the neshama has a presence in my mind, a major presence, not a minimal presence, but a maximum presence in my mind. It's actually controlling it. So anything done by the body, which is a byproduct, the activities of the body are a byproduct of the brain, of the mind, of the neshama. Since now the neshama is in full force, it's filling the brain properly in capacity, in maximum capacity, all the activities derived from the body can now be rectified. All damage done by the body can now be rectified. Like they say, the expression in the Gemara, Ein ani ela min hadaat. A poor person. Who is called a poor person? Someone who's poor in knowledge and wisdom. Ein ani ela min hadaat. Someone who's poor in wisdom. That is truly a poor person. The poverty a person has, whether physical or spiritual, is due to a lack of knowledge. So what's needed is to fill that person with knowledge, give him chokhmah by, like he's saying here, filtering out the negative and letting in only the positive. This is how you infuse a person with positive knowledge, positive wisdom, and by that a person gets out of the status of being poor to being really, really wealthy. Like the rabbis teach in the Pirkei Avot, Eizu Ashir Hasameach Bechelko, who is somebody who is wealthy? Someone who can be happy with his portion. He recognizes and values his portion. This person really is considered wealthy, and that's the opposite of the poverty due to a lack of knowledge. Give that person the knowledge, and they can be truly happy with their portion of what Hashem has given to them. Paragraph number 3. V'chol echad miYisrael. Every Jew, each and every Jew, yeshlo chelek elokah mima'al, has a piece of godliness from above within him. And what is this piece of godliness within every Jew? Shu bechinat chokhma. This is the idea of the knowledge that a Jew possesses, is the piece of godliness that he has within. Because true wisdom is the wisdom of the Torah, and the Jewish people are the ones who are obliged to learn Torah. It's their mitzvah, it's their commandment, it's their lifeline, because this is the source of true chokhmah, the wisdom of the Torah, the wisdom of the Chumash, the Mishnah, the Gemara, the Shulchan Aruch, the Zohar, the Kabbalah, the Midrash, Chassidut, every area of the Torah. That is what's called reflections of the true chokhmah, right? And this is something which is unique to the Jewish people, okay? And every Jew is entrusted with a piece of godliness within them. They have it within them. The Al Shem Zeh, because of the chokhmah that the Jewish person contains within him, the true knowledge, because of this, the Jewish people are called the first. Number one, Reshit. How do we know that they're called number one? And we're going to see why is he going into this. Why? What is Rebbe Nachman trying to tell us that the Jewish people are called Reshit? First of all, it's known that the Jewish people are called Reshit. Like it says, it's a verse in Jeremiah chapter 2. Verse number 3, Kodesh Yisrael Hashem, Reshit Tvuato. The prophet, on behalf of Hashem, says like this, holy is the Jewish nation to Hashem, Reshit Tvuato. They are the first of Hashem's crop. In other words, of the creations in this world, the Jewish people are first in Hashem's eyes. As if the whole world was created for mankind, but the purpose of mankind is for the Jewish people. Okay? That Am Yisrael was the whole goal, the Jewish people were the goal of the whole creation here. So we're called first. Because we're called first, that's why we're connected to Chokhmah. Because Chokhmah, knowledge, true knowledge, is also called Reshit, first. Like the verse says in Psalms, Reshit Chokhmah, Yirat Hashem. The beginning of knowledge, but it's called beginning. Reshit Chokhmah, Chokhmah is called Reshit, beginning, right? Reshit Yirat Hashem, the fear of God. In fact, Rashi, or the commentators on the Torah, on the very first of the Torah, right, Rashi brings this down. Bereshit bara Elokim et ha-shamayim et ha-aretz. It's the very opening word of the Torah, of Genesis. Bereshit. Rashi corrects how to properly translate Bereshit. The word Bereshit doesn't mean in the beginning, God created. That's a mistranslation. In the beginning, God created heaven and earth. That's a mistranslation. Translation, take a look at Rashi. Rashi explains the word Bereshit like this. On behalf of the first. What is the first? On behalf of the Jewish people who are called Reshit, Bara Elokim et ha-shamayim va'aretz, did Hashem create heaven and earth? But like Rashi says there on the very opening verse, it's not coming to say that the heaven and earth were the beginning of the creation. There were stages, and it doesn't begin with Et ha-shamayim va'aretz, heaven and earth. The stage is in the creation. Heaven wasn't created on the first day. Take a look how Rashi explains the procedure of the creation. What started first? Was it the depths, the water? Go take a look there in Rashi. But the point is that the Jewish people are called Reshit. And Rashi, and the Midrash also says on behalf of Chokhmah, on the behalf of the pursuit of true knowledge, Bishul Reshit, did Hashem create the world. The whole purpose of this world is to come and to connect to true knowledge, which is the knowledge of God. In other words, to come to reach a level of awareness that Hashem is the ruler of the world. That is basically all of Judaism. That's the whole Torah, is to have a recognition 24/7 that Hashem is running the world. That's the whole job of the Jewish people, that we maintain this awareness. We're meant to maintain this awareness every day of our life. Religion and Judaism is one. Being a Jew and religion and Emunah and Hashem is all together. That's the whole thing of being a Jew. It's a big responsibility that we have this goal to make ourselves aware 24/7 of Hashem's presence in the world. That is the knowledge of God. That's our mission here in this world. Begin the yishtemodin le. Like Zohar says, this world was created for the sake that people should get to know of Hashem. That Hashem should be made known in this universe, in this creation that we're in. Fine. So we're called Reshit, okay? Chokhma also is called Reshit. Fine. And our goal is to develop the mind. Aval bishat holada, he says here, but at the time of birth, when a child is born, what is the characteristics of a baby when they're born? Hasechel mitzumtzam. The intellect is very constricted. As we know the Midrash, that a child in the mother's womb is taught the entire Torah. A light, a divine light shining from one end of the universe to the other end, shines in the mother's womb, and this light shows, teaches, in other words, is the means of the child, the baby in the womb, seeing the entire Torah, learning the entire Torah. And at birth, as the child, the baby comes out, an angel, which is actually the Yetzihara, the evil one, he smacks a person on the upper lip and they forget the entire Torah, which is the reason why every baby, every normal healthy baby, comes out crying and screaming because of this big light which has just been lost to them. So that means that when a child comes out of the mother's womb, his mind is now at the maximum constriction because he just lost everything. Everything of the awareness of the Torah has been taken away by this from this child, and they're left with nothing. So the secha, the intellect, is very, very constricted by each and every person at the time of birth. And then the next stage, and when a person begins to use their mind, their brain, for the sake of contemplating and delving into the service of Hashem, because that's when the brain is truly being used for the right purpose to be developed, is when they use the brain for serving Hashem. This is why a Jewish child normally is taught already in the preschool levels belief and concepts of the Torah of Hashem, already from the beginning, at the very beginning, because this is the key for the proper development of the Jewish child's mind to develop properly in the service of Hashem. Already from the beginning, they're taught values and concepts of the Torah, of Hashem. They're taught about Hashem's awareness, right? So when a person begins then to start using the brain in understanding the service of Hashem, how Hashem wants us to serve Him in this world, as I sichlo holech v'gadol, then and only then does a person's intellect begin to expand. Kmo shekatuv, like it says about King Solomon, but Rabbi Nachman's using the term by King Solomon for every Jew. The verse reads like this: Vaterev chokhmat Shlomo, and the wisdom, the knowledge of King Solomon became very great above the average person, above every person in the world. That King Solomon's knowledge became very, very big and expanded, surpassing, bypassing every other human level. He reached the highest levels of knowledge. And Rabbi Nachman reads it like this: Chochmat Shlomo, the knowledge of Solomon, is meant to be read completing, shalem, Lehashlim, to complete. The word Shlomo, King Solomon, is related to the term Shalem, complete. To complete the knowledge, Vaterev, by expanding it, expanding the knowledge of the head till it reaches completion. And this is the goal of every Jew, to expand their knowledge, that it should fill the entire head. Okay, that's the goal here. That's like our goal, is to attain Chokhmah. The goal of the Jewish person is to attain true knowledge, the knowledge of Hashem. And that's considered the goal of this world, of our existence in this world. But when a person allows to enter into his mind, in his holy intellect, which was holy until now, machshavot chitzoniyot, foreign thoughts, which are hem chokhmot chitzoniyot, which are foreign ideologies, foreign knowledges, which shouldn't be there. So what happens to the brain, to the mind? Azai nitma'et kedushat sichlo. So then the holiness of the intellect becomes diminished. Commensurate to what? Commensurate to kfi tfisat hamakom shel hachokhmah chitzonit. According to, commensurate to how much space in the mind the foreign wisdom has taken up. Wow. Ve'al ha-sechel ha-chitzon hazeh, well, before we go on, just to explain. The mind, the human mind, is considered to be endless. We know that there's so much room in a head. A person's head can absorb so much. Now, the knowledge of Hashem, true knowledge, is considered above space. So true knowledge doesn't really occupy the brain physically. It doesn't take up physical space because it's above space. However, if now a person allows into their mind any type of knowledge which is considered foreign to this godly knowledge, that knowledge being under the dominion of space does take up space, and it diminishes the potential of the brain to connect to God. Because the nature of spiritual knowledge is that it fills up the entire mind. It doesn't just take a part. Godly chokhmah is meant to spread in its entirety to the entire brain. That's why we said the mind is called chokhmat shlomo. It's considered complete, because the godly wisdom, knowledge, is meant to fill the entire head. However, if there's a blockage, if there's something foreign stuck in the head, it does not allow the chokhmah to spread into the entire mind. And by extension, since the chokhmah is the seat in the mind to allow the neshama, the soul, to gain dominion of the mind, and thus be able to nurture and allow the body to be properly developed and healed, and to function properly, healthy, both physically and mentally at all the levels. So now, if a person allows something foreign stuck in the head, this does not allow the godly chokhmah to properly occupy the entire head, because it's called chokhmat shlomo. The knowledge in a person's head is called chokhmat shlomo, meaning it should fill full occupancy in the head. But there's something foreign blocking that ability, so that also, as a result, does not allow the neshama to properly function and reside in a person. And if the neshama is not properly residing in the person, it cannot help a person to overcome negative traits. A person feels so submitted when being tested. They feel they have to fall into the test. There's no other option. I have to eat that cake. I have to take that cigarette. I have to drink another shot in the alcohol. I have to fall into these false phobias and these negative attitudes, even though I know they're wrong, but I can't do anything. It's like the famous scenario that they put on the package of the cigarettes, smoking kills. And you see a picture of a dead person, or a person going through surgery, and yet the person knows it's dangerous. But what can he do? He's a victim to smoking, to addicted smoking. He can't get out of it, even though he knows it's bad. He knows it's dangerous. He knows about it. So if he knows about it, how come he can't overcome it? It's because something is stuck in the brain that's not allowing the chokhmah to proper, the godly chokhmah, to fill the entire head. And as a result, the neshama cannot fully occupy the head. And if the neshama cannot fully occupy the head, it cannot take control and nourish the body. So the body feels no need for addictions and negative traits and temptations, etc. There's control. You have people that they get angry and they can't control themselves of the anger. They can't learn to be cool and calm because there's something in them that doesn't allow them to have the self-control. The self-control, lack of self-control, is a lack of the neshama. The lack of the neshama in the person is a lack of chokhmah. The lack of chokhmah is due to that something finite, a knowledge which is finite, which is not real knowledge, has now taken up, if you want to call it, physical occupancy in the mind, which is a spiritual concept. The brain, the thinking process, is unlimited, but is allowed something which is finite to enter the brain, and therefore it can't mitpashet. It can't spread. I mentioned this before. Rabbi Ovadia Yosef of blessed memory, when he was married, alive, so he was just buying books, bringing more books and books of Torah into his house. And his wife started to complain, where are you going to put all these books? There's no room in the house. So he said to his wife, in here there's a lot of room, don't worry. I have a lot of room in my head. And the idea is that the mind has unlimited power. The knowledge of the Torah is so spiritual, is so pure, like we said, it doesn't take up physical space. It doesn't take up physical space. And that is the proper knowledge that should be filled into the head to allow Chochmat Shlomo, the wisdom of Solomon, meaning complete knowledge into the head. And this allows a person to expand. And when his knowledge is expanded, he can allow the neshama to really reside in it, like we said. Let's continue. So he says like this now. If now you allow a finite foreign ideology knowledge in your head, it begins to take up space and room and doesn't allow, it takes up actual place. And on this foreign intellect in your brain, in your mind, mitlaktim, mitchabrim, kol amidot ra'ot umegunot v'tavot, gathers and accumulates and joins together all of the bad traits, all the disgusting, low lusts and desires. And in the lesson itself, Rabbi Nachman compares it to sticking a reed in a flowing river. What happens is all types of garbage and debris and waste matter that's flowing in the river, when it touches and hits the reed, it sticks to it. The water's flowing. But all the impurities, waste matter that's in the river, they begin to accumulate over the reed. So when you pull out the reed from the water, all type of guck and filth of the water has accumulated around that reed. So too the mind is always in movement. It's like a river, a sea that has constant movement. And in the mind is entering all types of negative ideas, okay? But if now the mind is filled with holy knowledge, the negative ideas should normally go in and come out. They don't stay there. They're not meant to reside there. There's no room for them to reside there because of the occupancy of the holy knowledge in the brain. But when a person now is allowed foreign ideology to get stuck in the head, and it takes up finite place, room, so it's like a reed stuck in the water, in the flowing sea, the flowing river, in the moving sea. So then all these ideas which are negative, which come in and come out, come in and come out, they come in, but they get stuck and accumulate on that negative reed, if you want to call it, that's stuck in the brain. What's needed is to have it removed. If you get the reed out of the head, so all the negative traits that are accumulating around it won't stay in the person. They'll now just leave. There's nothing for them to parasite and stick to in the water, in the sea of the mind. The Yama Chochmah it's called. The wisdom, the sea of the knowledge. There's nothing for them to get stuck onto anymore, and it can just leave. So again, Rabbi Nachman's focus, check the head. Check what's in the head. That's where a person should aim to work on when wanting to deal with all types of therapies, therapy to try to help a person with this and this and that. go to the source, go to the person's head, and from there deal with the issues. See what a person is letting into them, because that has a major, major impact and influence on the person's actions. If the mind is filled with spirituality and godliness, so there's no room for negative traits to take form and to take presence. With this, I think we'll stop, because we have another paragraph coming up. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to get back to me. Here's my email address, meire at Breslov, Breslov dot org. There you go. It's on the screen there. It was great going through this lesson. You see that it's amazing. It's very, very useful, if you want to say. The teachings in this lesson are very, you know, shayach. It's something which is very necessary in this day and age with everything we're going through and all the things we have in our head. And again, especially now with the development of the internet, a person has access to much, much more information and sees things that he's never seen before, which also is knowledge. He's letting into the eyes a lot of bits of information that people 100 years ago never had access to. So our temptations and our ability to tap into a lot of knowledge is there. And we need much more filtering in order to give value to our mind and to adjust the proper level of holiness so we can overcome what we have to overcome in life. So, Bezat Hashem, I would really, really like people, if you have access to Rav Nosson's 50th Gate, Rav Nosson's prayer on this lesson, found in volume 2 of the English translation of Rav Nosson's prayer, is called the 50th Gate. Prayer number 35, see the opening 4 or 5 paragraphs of this lesson, you'll be amazed. If this is something that really bothers you, that you feel you need to work on, you will very much relate to Rav Nosson's prayer on this lesson, prayer number 35, something very amazing. I personally am doing this also, and I feel amazing. As someone who can relate to what I feel in my heart, words that really express what's inside of me, on this topic, you can really find it in this beautiful prayer of Rav Nosson. Have a wonderful week, everybody, and may you continue to delve in Rabbi Nachman's teachings, use them to overcome all types of tests and tribulations throughout the day, throughout the week, throughout the month, throughout the year, and throughout your entire life, to use Rabbi Nachman's teachings as a weapon to really succeed in becoming who you really are. All the best. Have a great week. Thank you, Ray. Thank you, Rina. Thank you, Beryl. Thank you, Zana. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Ms. Stoneman. All the best to all of you and all the other listeners. Have a great week. Shalom, shalom.